Welcome back to Strictly Politics. Let's read some of the tweets about Mercedes Gutierrez's resignation. Edward Kalugtong asks, akala ko ba ready siya sa impeachment? Is she ready?
Well, yes. Well, actually, the legal team and even the statement of the ombudsman, she firmly believes up to now that she didn't do anything wrong. Maybe the judgment may not have been the best to some for some people, but she feels that she did the best within her capabilities, mm-hmm. and there was nothing wrong with it. If there's delay, the records will show that it is all accounted for. Mm-hmm. But really, it was a judgment, a painful decision because of the family. You know, the mom even got very sick, very ill about it. It was even taking a toll on the ombudsman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was what one of our reporters had said, that the ombudsman's mother was very ill, and that she was concerned about the toll it would take on on her mother.
Yes, on the mom, on the family, uh-huh. and even on the ombudsman. She could not focus anymore on the work to be done. Because while she thought she would be able to do it, eventually the time was focused on the impeachment preparations and all of that.
Congressman Danilo Suarez had also told our reporter RG Cruz that one of the reasons that she resigned was because she did not have the financial ability to sustain this battle, this impeachment trial. Is there any truth to that?
Probably. It would have taken 5 months, 6 months, mm-hmm. Probably. But I don't know the financial state status of the ombudsman.
All right. Yes. Now, Blueville believes now that Gutierrez has resigned, dapat ituloy na sa ombudsman ang kaso against GMA and those involved in the fertilizer and ZTE scams. I am Goryo says the impeachment trial of Gutierrez is now moot and academic. Bawa sa ikakasakit at ikaiinit ng ulo ng sambayanan, ikorte pa rin yan. I Vasco asks, now that Gutierrez has resigned, sino kaya ang hiling ng karamihan na mag-resign? And finally, R. Dagle tweets, Mercy knows timing. Her resignation was eclipsed by the royal wedding. Well, that is another thing I wanted to ask you. Was that done on purpose, that she did it on the day that there was, you know, everybody's attention was focused on the royal wedding?
Well, no, naman, it just happened. That happened to be the day for the royal wedding. But I think it was just, well, the end of the month. She thought it would be a clean break. Decision was taken. It just happened. It's coincidental that the royal wedding.
Well, beautification pa sa Sunday.
Oh, right. So exactly. Diba? Parang maybe she was hoping that it matatabunan yung news. No, naman.
Well, she didn't want too much attention or focus. She wanted to just go into private life slowly. You know? Anyway, the objective was if she resigns and the administration now can move forward. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the important thing.
The JBC has decided that the new ombudsman would be given a fresh 7-year...
I spoke to Laila De Lima. Uh-huh. We had a meeting with the president this afternoon, and uh-huh. she mentioned that based on her reading of the Ombudsman Act, and it was also a position taken by the JBC.
That's right. The
new ombudsman will have a 7-year term.
So who has the final say on that, on the issue of the term? It's really the JBC?
I don't know.
It's the Supreme Court.
It can also be raised before the Supreme Court.
My
understanding was Chief Justice Corona was silent. Maybe out of the possibility it might be raised before the Supreme Court. But in general, the position taken by the JBC was that it's going to be, the new ombudsman will take a 7-year term.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Sikia, do you know how the ombudsman feels about this? I mean, after all, for a very long time, there were many people who were telling her that she should resign because she should only take a four years after taking over.
If you look at Section 8.3, I think, of 6770, it's very clear that if there is a vacancy arising from illness, resignation, the new ombudsman will be appointed for the full term. Mm. That's the exact word, full term. So she always believed that means 7 years.
So how does she feel now about this pronouncement from the DOJ and from the JBC?
Well, she didn't make any comment. I think for her, it's moot in academics. She's already leaving.
But nobody filed a case against her anyway.
Yeah, for mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. I know, I think some opinions stated that she should, it's void.
Even some members of the JBC, right? I mean...
I'm not sure, but there's nobody, no one filed a case.
No one filed the case. But I mean, previously, like a year or 2 years ago, there were some who were voicing.
I understand, Senator Chis Escudero had that opinion.
Because all members of the Constitutional Commissions only has a term of the unexpired portion.
Right.
So that's why Commissioner Larrazabal had to leave COMELEC.
Right.
Because unexpired portion.
He was only finishing, yeah.
And I think that was the argument against, not against, but on Chairman Villa, I think, of COA.
Yes.
that you only serve for the unexpired portion, rather than full term.
Mm-hmm. The understanding also is that the Office of the Ombudsman or the Ombudsman itself is not a collegial body.
Yes.
And therefore, it is not, you don't apply the doctrine governing the Constitutional Commissions to
the
Ombudsman.
As with the Comelec, for example.
That's the other argument there.
Okay. Well, there are some names that have already cropped up as to who's being considered for the post of Ombudsman. Professor June, what do you think of some of the names cropping up? We've heard, apart from Secretary Lecheda, still not confirming Associate Justice Carpio Morales. There's Chel Diokno, there's Rene Villa, there's Wabi Tanyada, so many names cropping up. Who do you think would make a good ombudsman?
I think ladies in the Philippines, I think it's a good choice.
So that's your first criteria. It's got to be a woman?
Because
I like you.
Because I think the Filipino woman is real. High quality, very very concerned with their work, very dedicated, and I think we should give them a chance.
And is that how you see Ombudsman Gutierrez, and how she fared?
No, I think...
your mind!
Gloria Arroyo, too.
Yeah, that's very true. Because you see, in my case, I've worked in my work in business, I've worked with women, mm-hmm. and they're really good workers. As a matter of fact, my colleagues in the American Chamber also think that their employees, lady employees, are really very good. It's
so
incomparable. Except for the fact that sometimes, you see, we sometimes blame a lot our leaders, but you see, our leaders could not have been good leaders out of the million of Filipinos. They rose from the ranks and they're intelligent, but you see, they respond to events, they respond to situations. Sometimes they're forced to do certain things that eventually gets them into trouble. But it's not because they're bad. I guess it's the context in which our society operates. Mm-hmm. And I think our problem sometimes is we force our leaders into situation where eventually we always blame them, and that's why every time we point the finger, there are three fingers pointing back at us. So it's our society that sometimes forces our leaders to be like that. So,
any other preference apart from or criteria apart from being a woman? What else is important, do you think?
Well, of course, competence is very important. I think all these people that has been submitted, I think they're highly competent. I don't think I can really see anything wrong with their qualification. And that's why I was just expressing my thoughts about women, because I think they're highly dedicated. Although, of course, sometimes there are certain situations that happens, and then you have GMA and you have this Mercedes.
Blame the woman.
Congressman Neri, who's on your wish list?
Yes, well, the criteria I mentioned before, credible. They must be credible with a track record of being, you know, an advocate against corruption. And
does
secondly,
anybody come to mind?
Independent. I'll go there in a while. Independent, not beholden to anybody, and I'm sure Edwin will agree with me, even with President Aquino. That's the ombudsman I prefer. Mm-hmm. And with the courage and the will to go after whoever, even if it's President Arroyo or whoever. So based on that, I'm sure there are many who would probably qualify sa criteria na yan. The problem is I don't know them. I don't know, you mentioned Mr. Rene Villa. No, I mean, I don't know the others. Like Rene Villa, I don't know. So the only ones I know are, of course, Chel Diokno and Bobby Tanyada. And I've known them for some time now, and as a human rights lawyer, I'm very much in favor of human rights lawyer. So for me, Chel and Bobby Tanyada would be very good.
And outside of that list, is there anybody else?
I don't know,
because
the others, Rene Villa. I'm sorry, I don't know him.
Sir, how true is it that the president was also considering former Chief Justice Puno?
I've not heard of
is
that.
Is Chief Justice one of the...
I've not heard of that. That's the first time.
Word going on around in the street. No?
The names there in the list, I don't know where you got them, but they're good names.
Those are good names. Do you have a preference? Are you allowed to say that?
I have no preference.
He's not allowed to say it.
I'm not allowed to say anything. But seriously, we have not sat down and discussed about the choice yet. It was really also so sudden. So we're looking at a protracted impeachment trial, actually. So
you're prepared for that. You know, we have a reporter who even bought an impeachment suit because he was prepared for going on camera all the time. Did you have your impeachment suit ready?
No, we're not supposed to be part of that. So
I know,
we're just going to observe and monitor.
But knowing that you'll be interviewed all the time because we couldn't interview people who were part of the prosecution.
Let's put it this way, Adel Tamano and Tom Skia just lost their jobs.
Before it began.
Yeah, didn't you?
Before it began.
But what is next for the ombudsman? On the 6th.
On the 9th, a private citizen.
And what's
next? She hopes that no one would file cases, but to be candid, it was also discussed, the pro and con, and she's fully aware that it's a possibility, it's a distinct possibility that people will still file against her. But at least she will face it as a private citizen, and then in the courts. Now, these are open anyway to the public, they can watch if they want. But really, she was hoping that sana wala na. But she's ready to face anything.
Well, as Secretary Lozada said earlier, it's really going to be a tough job ahead for whoever becomes the next ombudsman. So I guess we should all just wish him good luck.
Yes.
Well, Secretary Lozada and Attorney Sikia, Congressman Colmenares, and Professor June, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you.
And when we return, a look at how local blogosphere is buzzing on the death of Osama bin Laden. Strictly Politics, we'll be right back.